Let me just move straight to Ajahn Chah Sip. You know, if you look at Thailand and you think, okay, who would be an expert on at universities on China, who would know China, its social fabric, its history, speak the language, and so on, Ajahn Chah Sip would be at the top of the list. So he has a bit of a sore throat today, so I don't know how long, as long as you can speak, Ajahn, the floor is yours.
Good morning. Thank you very much. I'm very pleased and very honored to participate in this public forum. I would like to apologize for my sexy voice because I lost it last week. In fact, it was stolen by the microphone at Thammasat Rangsit campus. At 9 o'clock a week, last week, I gave a lecture on Thai foreign policy at 9 o'clock. Good voice, probably sexy one. But then by 12 o'clock, after 3 hours, my voice disappeared. So something wrong with the microphone. Some people say that it may be the Russians doing, but I doubt whether Russia is that interested in my lectures on Thai foreign policies. Anything bad, you always go to Russia, which I think is unfair for the Russians anyhow. Anyway, coming to today's public forum, I had a fear, you know, when I saw the list of the panelists, and I was put on the third of the list behind Toby. You know, everybody knows that when we speak, you know, everybody listens, and there's nothing left for others to speak. But it is not only a single fear. You know, after listening to Tim, so I have double fear with his experience with Gowie's analysis. Is there anything else for me to talk to you? Anyway, the show must go on. Therefore, I would like to make 3 points. One comment about the theme of today's public forum, and then 2 observations about the acronym we have, which look more like structures. I call this strategic structures or strategic architecture. So my 3 points, first one will be the comment on the China's way by comparing with the ASEAN way. Are there similarities, differences? My second point will be looking at these acronyms. At first, you know, I thought I know B-R-I-A-I-B-N-G-B-S-E-S-I-O-C. And I thought the ETC was a new one that I haven't heard before. No, I thought it may be European Transcontinental Cooperation or something. Only I heard this morning by a chat that it is et cetera. But anyway, that helped me a bit. My second point, you'll be looking at all these acronyms. Looking at these structures, is this Chinese strategic structures? Some of you have already mentioned. And my third point will be on the implications of the rise of China with the initiative of Xi Jinping on various strategic architecture and how it have an impact on international system, especially on the world order. Let me first comment the theme. When you hear the word China's way, and when you look at this acronym, it reminds me of the ASEAN way. And when we look at the ASEAN way, everybody know that we talk about ideas, about norms, about principle of interactions among ASEAN members. For example, consultation for consensus, non-interference in domestic affairs, informality, inclusiveness, non-use of force, peaceful settlement of dispute. These are norms, these are ideas, these are principles of dealing with each other among ASEAN. But when you look at the China's way, these are not ideas. When you look at BRI, Belt and Road Initiative, or Itaiilu, One Belt, One Road, or Obor. I hope they stop changing the name now, so I get confused. It looks more like a transportation connectivity platform or structures. AIIB, Asia Infrastructure Investment Bank. This is a financial structures, financial architectures. NDB, the BRIC, NDB, New Development Bank, the LFC, Lan Chang Mae Kong Corporation, SCS, as what I thought is Shanghai Cooperation System, but it turned out that it is South China Sea issues. And then the LMC, Lan Chang Mae Kong Corporation. All these are not ideas. They are not the norm, but they are in fact concrete structure that China set. So I don't think this is the China's way. It is the China's architecture, the China building block for something. What is that something? I think if you want to find out, you have to go and to read not only volume one of the governance of Xi Jinping, which has published a few years ago, now volume two already is coming out, in order to understand why. I know this comes during Xi Jinping period, only in the past 5 years, all this initiative, all this structure has been put forward. In another word, this is the Chinese strategic architecture that we are talking about. Let's come, that's my first point. Let's come to the second point, my observation about these structures or strategic architecture. It's all come up in the past 5 years when China was under Xi Jinping, and it's all related to Zhongguo Meng, Jiao Shi, Hong Long Meng, Hu Shi Hong Long Meng. Hong Long Meng is the red dragon. Xena, Xi Jinping, is the red dragon. He is red because he's from revolutionary families, and he is the dragon of China. So, Zhongguo Meng Jiao Shi Hong Long Meng. What does that mean? You remember when he was appointed the party secretaries in November of 2012. 2 weeks later, he went to visit a museum, like look at the exhibition, and he gave a speech. And in that speech, he first thought about this woman. And he explained it to rejuvenate the Chinese nation. And after that, all the others came out. All the building blocks came up. A year later on, in 2013, he went to Kazakhstan and start talking about Itai, the Silk Road economic belt linking China to the West, to Central Asia, and then to Europe later on. And later that year, 2013, he went to Jakarta and gave a talk at the parliament talking about the Yilu, the Silk Road, the maritime Silk Road of the 21st century. In the meantime, he also mentioned another key concept, community of common and shared destiny. And that is also important. It looked like that is the goal that he would like the world to be, to appear to be that way. So Zhongguo Meng, or the China's team, is related to all these structures. And Zhongguo Meng, to rejuvenate China, he has the goal. The goal is double 100. 2021, 100 years anniversary of the founding of the Chinese Communist Party. And the second goal is 2049, 100 year anniversary of the founding of the People's Republic of China. Among these two goals, you could learn more about these two goals when you read those 66 pages of Xi Jinping, 3.5 hours. And anybody interested, you can read it in here. I read it because I have to give another talk on Monday about similar topics. What Tim has already summarized what is in this. And I think you should read this. Not only this, but many of Xi Jinping's speech also give us the clue of his strategic architecture that we are talking about. So the two goal period, 2021 and 2049. These are the goal that China is expecting. In his letter speech at the Party Congress, the Chi Qiu Da, the 19th Party Congress, he talked about, he gave more some more detail about what he expects China will be in the next 30 years. He divided into two periods, from 2020 to 2035. The first 15 years, China will achieve a Xiaokang, a moderately prosperous country. And then the second period from 2036 to 2050, China will become what a strong, civilized, harmonious country, fully developed. So China has a grand strategy, not only for herself, but also the grand strategy of the new world order. Let me go to my third point. Hopefully my point is still with me. I have both the Thai herbal medicines and also the Western medicines with me in case I need it. I'm well prepared. My third point is about the implication of this security architecture initiated by Xi Jinping in the past 5 years, and I'm sure that there will be more to come in the future. Especially, you have to be watchful for this 19 People Congress, which is coming up the next month in March. It's easy to predict who will be the vice president of China. You know that the president will be Xi Jinping. It's easier to predict who will be the vice prime minister. But what are the game plan? What are the policy? Definitely it will follow the 66 pages, 3.5 hours scheme that Xi Jinping has mentioned. But what are the details? What are the priorities? What are the things? I think we will be looking at that later on. But what I want to say is that the strategic architecture that Xi Jinping has been building up in the past 5 years, are they competing or complementing the existing international system or world order initiated by the West and the United States since the Second World War? Since the end of the Second World War, the victorious Western country set up a new system, a new world system, a new world order. What do we mean by new world order after the post-World War? I would say that world order is the arrangement of relationships among state actors so as to bring about peaceful relationship, peaceful coexistence, and economic prosperities among the members. For the world order to be sustainable, they need two things. First, world order need to have norms, agree norms, and then they need to have functional mechanism. Norms are principles, ideas, rules, regulations agreed upon by the member state. Mechanism are institutions or meetings, organizations to monitor that all members agree, commit, comply to the norms. The world order after the Second World War has two important aspects. One is the world political orders. The other one is world economic order. And these two are set up by the US and the Western allies after the Second World War. For the world political orders, the norm is peaceful settlement of conflict And you can see that written in Article 1 in the United Nations Charters. And power who will look after this is the United Nations Security Council with 5 countries. And the mechanism was the UN. For the economic world orders, you have 2 sub-dimensions, the trade dimension as well as the financial or monetary dimension. Trade and monetary are linked to each other. If you have a good, stable money, then trade will expand. So for the trade economic world order, the Second World War, the norm was free trade. At first, in Havana, they want to set up ITO with both the norms and also the mechanism, but they disagree on the mechanism. So ITO, International Trade Organization, was thrown out. They keep only half of it, and they call it GATT, General Agreement on Tariff and Trade. Later on, by 1995, they think that it is important to have a mechanism, so World Trade Organization was set up. China joined later on. For the monetaries, exchange rate stability is very important through the gold standard system. So those with mechanism IMF and World Bank, ADB and other regional banks, so those were the existing world order that has been with us for more than 70 years. And many states benefit from it. Many small states, big states, but they do not benefit equally. China also benefit, and China also realized that China did not benefit equally. And that's why I think China would like to change, if China has the capability. But from 1990 onward, China must strengthen themselves. In the past 3 decades, I think China realized that China has been successful in their economic development, which benefit from this world order. But China was also quite unhappy with several aspects of this world order. In the past 10 years, more than 10 years, when I have visitors from Chinese scholars, from Seeger or from others, they always told me why Thailand and ASEAN still continue with this Cold War mentality, with the alliance system with the United States, can be set up anew. They always criticize about that. At the same time, they also criticize about the economic structures. And that's why you see that when China has been successful economically through this modernization reforms unleashed by Deng Xiaoping from 1979 onward, I think for 30 years, China has been very successful. China has been able to become the second largest economy in just one generation. China became the largest exporting country, surpassing Germany. Not to mention many of these accomplishments. China is quite confident. China was able to weather through many crises. For example, the Asian financial crisis of 1997. Then the subprime crisis of the United States. Later on, the public debt crisis of Europe. China was able to weather through this. And at the same time, China witnessed the economic weakness and the economic decline of the West, with the United States, with Europe as well. Consequently, I think China came to realization that opportunity has arisen for China to take a stage, to play. Other people have been criticizing China for not performing according to responsibility. In fact, there are 2 factors, the external factors and the internal factors. The external factor is that you saw the power shift in the 21st century. The power shift has two aspects. The first one is, I call the transitions of power. Power was no longer focused or concentrated in the Western United States or Europe, but it transitioned into Asia. And many people have been talking about the Asian centuries. But in fact, let me recall, 100 years ago in the year 1905, John Hay, the Secretary of the State of the United States, in 1905, he said, let me quote, "Mediterranean was the ocean of the past. Atlantic is the ocean of the present." And the present means 1905. "And Pacific will be the oceans of the futures." When you look at the Pacific nowadays, the three largest economies are in the Pacific. United States, especially the West Coast. China, and then Japan. And in the near future, maybe the Indo-Pacific will be the new stage of wealth and powers. So that is the transitions of power. The other one is diffusions of power. Power is no longer concentrated in the state, but in fact, it filtered through into not state actors anymore, but also to non-state actors that we have to pay attention to. So the transitions of power and the diffusions of power are the key element in the external strategic environment of the world of the 21st century. Internally, China also see that their economic development has been successful, and they were different from what the Western has been proselytized. For the West, economic success comes from market capitalism, comes from liberal democracies, and the priority of political rights over other rights, human rights. But for China, China has proved in the past 30 years that success of economic growth can come from state capitalism, as has already mentioned. I fully agree with him on that. Moreover, liberal democracy is not the prerequisite for the success. In fact, China showed that democratic centralism can also bring about the economic growth, the eradication of certain poverties. And moreover, China also showed that the priority of economic right is important than the political right. So in other words, we are facing the phenomena in which two models are competing with each other. The Western model of economic growth and the Chinese model. I don't think that China wants to export it models, but I think China wants to demonstrate that there are the alternative, and China want to show the alternative of economic, that it's not supposed to be a linear progression to economic growth. There are in fact many other ways, and China is other way. Thailand has to find their own way. China, Thailand cannot follow the Chinese way anyhow. Therefore, to conclude my remark, in other words, we are seeing two competing economic models as well as two competing world orders. The Western US-centric world order and China-centric world orders. With BRICS, which is the I would say that BRICS represent the political aspect. You know, in the world political order set up by the West, you have the Perm 5. Is China presenting the BRICS as the new five countries representing various aspects of the world? That is something to keep pondering. Economically, we discussed already about the the AIIB, the NDB, which at the same time complement as well as compete. In other words, China is showing that there is an alternative. It's up to you to choose. You can have both, or you can watch and choose one or the other. In other words, China is presenting an alternative to the world, whether which one you prefer. In terms of the socio-cultural dimensions of the world order, China has set up the Confucius Institute, Confuci. The Confucius Institutions and also the Chinese Cultural Center has been established all over the world. So with this in mind, are these two competing world orders? They are cooperating at the same time as well. So in fact, what we are seeing is that these two models are working with each other like yin yang. And what is the result? There are two results. One is the Marxist result. Thesis versus antithesis, it becomes a synthesis. They may transform into one. Or the yin yang will keep on going forever. And I think I am more likely to feel that the yin yang will keep on going forever, but at the same time transform the yin and the yang. Because they learn from each other. They are not stupid. They know the weakness of each side. So they are improving each other. So we will see the yin yang competing, complementing, transforming each other for several decades from now. In that case, what can small state like Thailand or ASEAN will do in this never-ending competitions between the two models? I would like to say that China respects three types of powers. The first type of power that China respects is military powers, force. The second one is economic powers, wealth. I think Jim discussed very well at the very beginning. But the third type that China also respects, the third power, is intellectual power or wisdom. Small states like Thailand and ASEAN cannot match the Chinese military power. We cannot match the Chinese wealth or economic power. The only thing left is that the intellect powers, the wisdom. In the past 50 years, ASEAN has wisdom. But in the past, we depend upon people, individual persons, like Lee Kuan Yew, Prince Wan Vaithiyakorn of Thailand, Thanat Korman. We may not be that lucky, because things did not go slow at that time for us to accumulate the knowledge. Now we are in a high speed digitalization. Therefore, knowledge, wisdom is very important to deal, to manage with China and the United States. And I hope that we will come here again to exchange our idea so that we can accumulate and crystallize the wisdom so that we are able to manage this yin-yang relationship between China, United States, between West and Asia for the benefit of all mankind. Thank you very much.